So let's look over this and remind ourselves about you know, like the numbers that we see in the equation and why they wind up doing the things that they do, okay? And get out of a, hopefully get out of a shortcut mindset, as if I couldn't understand or do math if I didn't have shortcuts, all right? I'm about to explain something to you that I've said many times, okay? And I know that you all have the capability of understanding it. It's just a matter of saying, I'm going to pay attention, I am going to listen to this, I am going to internalize this, and I'm not going to sit and wait for the shortcut only. Shortcut will come, because we're mathematicians. That's what mathematicians do. They find shortcuts, they find patterns. Okay. But let's understand behind the scenes stuff so that we don't get confused. Alright? So let's take a look at number 9. I'm sure the equation for number 9 looks like make sure y equals negative 4/5 x minus 2. Okay, we're going to draw the graph of this. And as I've said many times, all graphs are, well, are all the same in one way. There's lots of different shape graphs, lots of graphs in different positions, pointing in different directions, right? They all look different. They look a lot different. But they all have this thing in common. Okay? All graphs have this in common. Let's see if you remember. They're all made of what? Zach?
Points.
Okay. Now, let that really sink in. Not, you know, you say points, do you really know what that means? Right? Let's look at a graph. If we were looking at this graph, okay, the squiggly thing. It's not just a squiggly line, not just a curvy curve. It's actually made up of, it has little building blocks, just like we're made of atoms and molecules. This thing is made of a bunch of little points. Okay, there's one. I've just drawn like 15 or 20 points in this tiny little section, and I could draw infinitely many more just in this tiny section. Okay? The reason why we draw it like a curve, just one straight curve like that, or a continuous curve, is we don't have time to just plot all those points and see what happens and just see what shape comes out of that. And that's why we need to get to shortcuts eventually, because we don't have time to plot all those points. But we can't just ignore that it's made of points. We can't just ignore where those points come from, like where do they even originate. Otherwise, we're going to find ourselves trying to take a test and say, oh, I don't understand this at all. But it's a very simple thing. It's made of points. And where do those points come from?
People.
They do not, they not come
numbers.
From people.
Equations.
They come from equations. They do come from equations. Okay? Here's an equation. Okay? And every equation that has an x and a y are two variables. They might have different names, but it has two variables. There's always some kind of graph that we can draw. Okay? Whatever that equation might be. So let's find the graph of this equation. The graph comes from the equation itself. Right? There are these points on the plane. They represent numbers. These numbers are related to this equation. Right? Can someone tell me, how about this? Can someone tell me an x and a y that I can plug into this equation and it will be an equation. It will be equal.
Zero.
Okay, zero for what?
For this, for x.
For x. I can plug zero in for x. What can I plug in for x? What are some options I can plug in for x?
Two. One.
Five.
20.
90. 600.
We have not yet said anything that doesn't work. All these numbers are fine. You can plug anything we want in for x, right? Absolutely anything. Pi. And that's why we even came up with the idea of a graph as a, you know, as a race of human beings that eventually discovered math and wanted to see all the solutions to this equation. We came up with the idea of a graph. Because there are so many solutions, an infinite number of solutions to this equation, whatever I plug in for x makes a new y, and that's a new solution. If I do plug 0 in for x, then what would y have to be so that this would be equal? gonna have to be? Or like what does y end up being, right?
Zero.
Y being zero. Well, let's see. Y equals negative 4/5. Okay, I'm putting zero in for x, and I'm gonna see what happens. Now what's negative 4/5 times zero?
Zero.
Zero, okay. So that part's zero, that's zero minus two, so we're left with a minus two then.
Maybe one. Oh no, two. There you go.
What is y then?
Negative two.
Y equals negative two. Okay. So there's one solution. Among infinite many solutions. If I plug this x and y in here, like I put a negative two in there for y, and I put a zero in for x, I get zero here, I get negative two equals two. It's true. They are both sides are equal, and so that's the solution.
What?
Let's find another solution. Robert.
Five?
Assume you mean for x. Plug in a five for x. I like five. I like that idea. Absolutely anything can be plugged in for x, even negative 0.325. Anything you can think of, but five is a makes it easy to figure out what y would be. Here we go. Y equals negative 4/5 times 5 minus 2. You can think of it as 5 over 1. 5 divides this 5. We're left with a 1. Negative 4 times 1 is negative 4. But you ask yourself, is what I'm doing right now helping me learn this topic? Drawing pictures helping you? Be among the minority of people who can draw pictures of things unrelated to this and just absorb new knowledge. In fact, this isn't new knowledge. This is old knowledge. You've done this, I don't know how many times. So many times. If you don't know it now, it clearly didn't work the first time you tried drawing pictures while I was telling you what's up about a graph. Okay? So if we put a 5 in for x, the 5 divides the 5, wind up with 1. Negative 4 times 1 is negative 4. Negative 4 minus 2, negative 6. So that was easy. Looked like there's no fractions involved there. That was a nice little thing that happened.
Oh,
so Robert's idea was a good one. We put it to 5, we get out a, well, another whole number.
What if you use like 20?
That's handy. What if you use 1? Right? Is that what you said?
I said 20.
Oh, 20.
Yeah.
What if we do use 20? Okay, y equals negative 4/5 times 20 over 1 times 2. 5 divides 20, and then, well, now, what does that leave this time?
4.
4. 5 divides 20, leaving a 4. So negative 4 times 4 is?
4.
16.
Negative 16 times 2y equals negative 18. Okay, that was handy. It was handy to plug in something for x that's divisible by 5, okay? There's like either you're very familiar with that, or there's at least like a little residual in there that's sticking in your brain that says, well, what if I plug in something there that'll cancel out the 5? What if we don't? What if we plug in something like 1? Plug in a 1. Well, that's negative 4/5 times 1 minus 2 y equals negative 4/5 times 1 is just negative 4/5 minus 2. Well, how am I going to add these together?
You put 2 over 1.
Okay, we put 2 over 1. And then what?
And then you subtract.
No, we subtract fractions. We need a common denominator, yeah. So this will be 10 over 5. So negative 4 over 5 minus 10 over 5. Negative 14 over 5. Good. Well, I did all my work right. That is correct, right? Y is negative 14 over 5, but it's kind of.
You make the positive their way. You make it positive.
You just make this positive?
Like, no, like a number that will make it positive.
Oh, because we've gotten negative numbers every time so far. Well.
Use a negative.
Use a negative number? What do you think, Robert?
Negative 5.
Let's try negative 5. That holds some promise because a negative number times a negative number is what?
Positive.
Positive number. And as long as subtracting 2 from that number Right, if two is not so big that it takes that number and pulls it into the negatives, then we'll wind up with a positive number. So the 5 divides the negative 5, leaving a negative 1. Negative 4 times negative 1 is 4. Minus 2. 4 minus 2 is still going to be a positive number, right? So there we did it. We wind up with a positive number. All right, so if we plug in a negative 5 for x, we get a positive 2 for y.
That makes sense.
Good. So we've found 5 solutions. How many are there left to find?
Infinite.
Yes. So we don't have time to do that, do we?
No.
That's where the idea of a graph comes from. We want to get an idea of what the solutions to this equation are, but we can't possibly find them all. But we can look at a lot of them. We can kind of see a picture of a lot of them. That picture that I'm talking about is a graph. Okay, so the solutions to this equation are actually numbers, right? These numbers right here, these numbers are a solution, these numbers are a solution. Now we take those numbers and we can translate them, almost like, you know, into another language. This is the language of numbers and symbols. This is the language of coordinates.
Yeah.
But those coordinates represent numbers. We can represent this with a point that is right there. If you've never seen a graph before, I would definitely take my time and explain what I mean by that. But this guy has the coordinates 0, negative 2. The x coordinate is 0. It's not on the right. It's not on the left. It's right in the middle. The y coordinate is negative 2. It's 2 down on the y axis. There's that point, 0, negative 2. Okay. Now, this point itself is not a solution. Right? It's not numbers. The point is a point. It's a dot. It's a place in the plane. It's just a place. But it represents a couple of numbers, these two numbers, 0 and negative 2. Okay? So that point tells us what a solution to this equation is by where it's located. What its coordinates are the solution to this equation, or one of the infinitely many solutions.
0, negative 2.
So there's one. We translated that into a point.
Ooh.
And now that point, a very small point, tells us useful information about this equation, one of the solutions is. 5, negative 6. So if I want to represent 5 for x and negative 6 for y, I go 5 on the x-axis, right? X. X is 5, and y is negative 6. There's another point. Okay. So I've condensed these numbers that take up a lot of space to write. I've condensed them down to this tiny little point. That tiny little point tells you the exact same information. That if x is 5 and y is negative 6, then both sides of this equation will be equal. I plug those two in. I can't go all the way out to 20, it's too far.
Oh.
If I could, though, you know, I would go out twice as far as this and go way out there off the board and just to the left of that cabinet there and go down 18 from there, which would take me a couple cinder blocks down on the wall, and I put a point down there. And that, too, would represent a solution to this equation. 1 and negative 14 fifths. Okay, we can turn this into a mixed number. That makes it easier to think about how big this number is, right? So this would be negative 2 and 4 fifths. Negative 2 and 4 fifths. So if x is 1 and y is negative 2 and 4 fifths, right, that's almost 3, almost negative 3. What do you notice about those three points? Yeah?
They're all aligned.
Yes, they're all in a straight line. Now, if you were to throw three points up there randomly, it's not very likely that they would be in a straight line. But these happen to be, so it seems like there's some kind of a pattern arising out of the where these points are going to fall based on the solutions of this equation. It seems like they're all lining up in a straight line. Okay. Well, we're almost out of solutions to condense down to points and put on a graph, but Robert's given us another useful one by putting in negative 5. If x is negative 5 and y is 2, that's another solution. Okay. So here comes the shortcut. We're noticing that all these points are forming what kind of a shape, or seem to be?
A
line shape.
What's
a line's a shape. So it seems like if I were to follow this line pattern, I bet you I'd find another point, and then that point I could translate into a solution as well. Right?
Yeah.
See that pattern?
Yeah.
The pattern is, well, let's start with this point here. I could come to the right 5 and go down 4. There's another point that represents a solution. Go to the right 5, go down 4, and there's another point that represents another solution. I bet if I were to go over another 5 and down another 4, on that same straight line, I'll bet you that that is also, right? If I translate that point where its coordinates are, translate it back into the numbers that it represents, I bet those numbers would be a solution to this equation as well. What solution does this point represent?
10, negative 10.
10, negative 10. Yeah, that's what it looks like it is. 10, negative 10. I'll bet that's a solution. Let's try it out. Okay, y is negative 10. That's what that point is saying. X is negative 10, so we'll put, or not negative 10, positive 10. All right, negative 10 on this side. 5 divides the 10, leaving it 2. Negative 4 times 2 is negative 8. Minus 2. Since both sides came out to be equal, then that must be a solution. 10 negative 10 must be a solution. I bet if I go the other way, I bet if I go back 5 and go up 4 and stay on that same line pattern, then I'll find another solution. This point is telling me that another solution would be negative 10 for x and 6. It's hard to see from back there. Sometimes you get off by 1 or 2. So this one's right here at 6. So if x is negative 10 and y is positive 6, we plug in negative 10 for x and 6 for y, and then both sides turn out to be equal to each other. So we're again making the point that every graph, including these line graphs, which are the only graphs we've ever graphed so far, that they're made of what? Points. And the points come from where?
Equation.
The equations. Okay. So don't ever forget that. If you're ever in a pickle, a graphing pickle, and you don't know what this graph is supposed to look like, or you forget what the shortcut is, and you can't remember, is it up this much and over that much, and did I get it flipped backwards, or if you're ever at a loss for what to do when you're graphing, you can just find some solutions, right? Find out what x and y need to be in order to make both sides equal. If plug in x, right, if it's all set up like this, or you just plug in x and do all the math, and it tells you what y would have to be. And you're going to have a couple solutions. You're pretty sure that graph's supposed to, if all those points would line up into a straight line, well, now you have enough information to draw that straight line. If it's supposed to be more curvy, you probably need to graph more points to figure out exactly what that curve looks like. But for now, we're drawing straight lines, and if I can find a couple of points, then I can draw that line. Aubrey?
Since we just did like a review and stuff for our homework, does that mean we have a quest coming up soon? Like another one?
No, it doesn't. All right, so now we can be sure that that for the time being, the graphs that we're gonna draw. Just tell you guys are waiting for me to turn around so you can look at each other. Start giggling again.
Yep.
Just stop. Just try and focus up here.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So we found. What here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We found already do it. Stay focused up here. Do you have your notes out? Are you writing things down?
Yeah.
Okay. So we found 6 points, 6 solutions to this equation. We can find infinitely many more, but we don't have time, and that's why we have a graph. And what I've noticed about this graph, what we've all noticed about this graph, is these points are in a straight line, so I bet. If I were to go over to like 4, right, x is 4, y would have to be, something down here, like, you know, probably negative 4 and a fifth.
Negative 4 and 1 fifth. I bet you that's it.
I bet you if x was 4 and y was negative 4 and 1 fifth, then both sides of the equation would come out equal. Okay. So if we kept making those guesses, guessing that a point goes here, 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 and here, and here, and here, and here, and here, what we would wind up getting is a straight line. A straight line is made of all those points which represent solutions. I'm giving you this whole explanation because whenever you raise your hand, I come over to your desk, and you ask me a question, and you say, I remember that I was supposed to put a point at 2, but I can't remember if it's 2 or negative 2, and then I know this is the slope, but I can't remember if it's, is it up 5 and over 4, or is it over 4, is it up 4, is it over 5? That you missed the point, okay? Graph is the points. The points come from the equation. If you can't remember the shortcut, don't try and remember the shortcut gooder.
Better.
Right? Gooder. Don't try and get better and better and better at remembering the shortcut. Go back to what the graph is. The graph is made of points. The points, this equation will tell you exactly where the points should be. Ask the equation where the points should be. Find the points. Graph the points. Connect the points. Don't rely on your ability to remember a shortcut. If you're having trouble with it, do this, and the shortcut will become evident. Look at that. The y-intercept is at negative 2. Right? That's pretty obvious, because if I plug in 0 for x, all that's left is negative 2. So I know the y-intercept should be negative 2. Okay? Now for the slope. Is it up 5? Is it over 5? Is it up 4? Is it over 4? If I graph a few points, I find, it's very clear, that it go the next point, the next easy point to find is to the right 5, and it's down 4. Because every time I plug in a 5, or a multiple of 5, then I get a nice whole number for y. That's, like, the secret behind the slope, that 5 x's that are multiples of 5 are the x's that we want to use when we plug in values of x into this equation. Every time I plug in a different x, I would like, if I could, my preference would be to plug in an x that is a 5, or a 10, or a 15, or a 20, or negative 5, negative 10, negative 5, negative 20, anything that's going to get divided by this 5. Now we start to understand the denominator of this number holds the key to that horizontal pattern, the horizontal pattern, okay? Since the denominator is going to divide whatever you plug in for x, you'd like that thing that you plug in for x to be divisible by 5, so you'd like to go over 5, over 5, over 5. So the question of is it over 5 or is it up 5 clearly becomes it's over 5. We're going to move over 5. Every time I move over another 5, I subtract another 4 because it's negative. I'm going to go down. I subtract another 4. If I go over a single 5, I'm going to subtract a single 4. If I go over 5 and another 5, I'm going to subtract 4 and 4 again. And the pattern becomes you go over 5. Every time you move over a 5, you go down another 4. Over another 5, down another 4. Yeah, Lane.
What happens if you do a negative 10 on the x side?
If you do a what now?
A negative 10 on the x side.
You know, plug in a negative 10?
Yeah, right there.
Well, this
goes straight up.
This since I just followed, all I did was follow the line, and I found a point at negative 10, 6. I bet what will happen is we'll get 6 for y. Now let's just test it out and find out that we're right about that. Y equals negative 4 fifths times negative 10 minus 2. Let's see what happens. 5 divides the negative 10. 5 dividing negative 10 is will say negative 2. What's negative 4 times negative 2?
Negative
8. Negative 4 times negative 2.
Negative
8. Negative 4
positive
times negative 8. 1. Negative times negative is positive, so it gives us a
positive
8. 8. 8 minus 2?
6.
It's 6. Look, exactly what we thought would happen just by following the line. Put a negative 10 for x, you get a 6 for y.
You're doing some practice, plugging in some numbers for X, finding those numbers for Y, noticing the pattern, seeing that there is a that all these kinds of equations come out to be graphs that are straight lines, and that there are pretty easy ways to figure out where that line should be. Okay? Let's try. No, let's not do that.
Let's try
a couple, like 3/4 X plus 1. Then let's do a different one. Let's get done with that one. Try this one. Y equals 4/7 X minus 3.
We have to have 2 points.
Well, anything that looks like this, which these both do, a number times x plus some other number, even if those numbers are fractions and decimals, still, it's going to be a line. So yes, seeing that it's going to be a line, we really just need 2 points. For this first one, let's find a bunch of solutions. Okay? So, Zach, do you have a solution?
Heck.
Five. What's that?
Five.
That's
a
terrible solution.
Four is
five around X.
Okay, X is five, and what's Y?
I didn't get Y. I was still working on it.
Without a Y, you don't have a solution. You need two numbers to be a solution.
What?
I need two numbers, an X and a Y, in order to have a solution. Ready?
Zero
for X, and one for Y. Okay? Is that a solution?
Yeah.
How do we know?
We have to plot it.
And plotting is not going to tell us that it's a solution. What tells us that it is a solution?
Okay,
plugging zero for X, if you get one for Y, you know you did it right. Or, I know it. Now the bad decisions are making it difficult for everybody else. Hold on. If we plug in 0 for x and we plug in 1 for y, when we do all the math, it's going to come out true. Like, both sides are going to be equal. Let me show you that something that's not a solution, like 0, 2. I know that's not a solution. Watch this. 2 for y, 3/4 times 0 for x is 1. Okay, so it's 2. 3/4 times 0 is 0. 0 plus 1 is 1. That's not true. So I know 0 for x and 2 for y is not a solution. It doesn't come out equal. Right. Lane, do you have a different solution?
I think so. I did 8 and 25.
8 and 25. Let's see if that's a solution by just plugging each of those in for x and y, and if it comes out equal, then we know we did it. 25 for x, 3/4 times 4 over 1 plus 1. 5 equals. Okay, now when we multiply fractions, we multiply straight across. So we'll multiply 3 times 4, that's 12.
Wait, isn't it an 8?
Oh, yeah, you're right. He said 8. Okay, so 3 times 8 is 24. Over 4 times 1 is 4, plus 1. Is 24, can you divide 24 by 4?
Yep, 6.
Six.
Oh, I did that wrong. Hey, guys.
6 plus 1.
7.
Oh, that's 7. And see, it doesn't come out equal, so we know it's not a solution. But if we go back and change what we plugged in for y,
I got seven.
So 8, comma 7 is a solution. Kaden?
4 is x and 3 is y.
All right, let's give it a check. Let's see, 4 for x, 3 for y. 4 for x, we get 3 times 4 is 12, 4 times 1 straight across is 4 plus 1. 3 equals 12 divided by 4 is 3 plus 1. No, that's not a solution because 3 is not equal to 4. So if we were to change the y value to 4, I'll let you
hear somebody or see somebody who's making class not run very smoothly, I'll just pause and let you help correct the problem. Sounds good now? Let's find another solution. Jackson.
12 for x and 10 for y.
Okay, let's take a look. 10 for y and 12 for x. We have 12 is 36 over 4 plus 1. What's 36 divided by 4? 9 plus 1. 10 equals 10, checks out. Must have been right. 12 equals 12 for x, 10 for y. Okay. Well, let's just listen to what I'm saying. Stop crumpling paper, stop making noises that are not as related. Okay? Look up here. Now, we have four solutions. Each pair of numbers is one solution. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4. We'll represent them on the graph and we'll look for a pattern and we'll once again confirm this y-intercept and slope idea. Alright. 0, 1. There is a point on the plane with the coordinates x is 0 and y is 1. And now I can interpret that information as x being 0, y being 1 is a solution. 8, 7. Now what are we going to do, Aubrey?
Now you have to plug the 4 and 4.
Okay, where's that going to be?
Well, it's going to be on the x, it's going to be like 4.
Okay.
And then you go up 4.
5 or 4?
4.
4. We go up 4.
Yeah.
And then what are we going to do?
And then you go up.
5. Now
what? And then...
Should I make a line?
Yeah.
Why?
Because it connects them. It makes a straight line.
What does?
The dots.
Solution.
The points so far are in a straight line.
Yeah, it's the solution.
And if we were to plug in like 3 or 1 for x or 2 for x or 3 for x, do you think that the point that we would get from that solution would be in a straight line as well?
Yeah.
I think so. I think it would be.
Yeah.
Okay. So I bet there's a point here.
There's a point here,
and I bet they all fall in a straight line like this. I have not asked you to leave yet. Okay. So what we notice that every time we see an equation that looks like this, we can confirm it with this one as well, that there is a point on the y-axis at positive 1. That one's obvious because if we plug it in 0 for x, all that's left is that 1. Yeah, we're still here. And the longer I address that, the longer we'll be here. So let's just pay attention, please. Then every time I put in a multiple of 4 for x, I'm just going to go up another 3. If we put in a 4 for x or an 8 for x or 12 for x, I'm just going to go up in amounts of 3 in the y direction. All right, have a good day.